Hello, in my last class, we discussed the operation of power MOSFET, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. It's a very fast device, much faster than a BJT. There are three terminals, similar to a BJT. They are drain, gate, and source. Okay. Gate is insulated from the source. There is a SiO2 layer, okay, which is an insulator. So the input impedance or the impedance between gate and source is very high, and it is mainly a capacitive. So how does the current flow from drain to source? When the applied voltage between gate to source is higher than what is known as the threshold value, a N channel is formed and which connects the drain to source. See in this figure, when the applied voltage is higher than the threshold value, a small conducting channel is formed below the silicon layer. Okay. So electrons starts flowing from this N plus layer to N minus layer, okay, in this fashion, or the current starts from drain to source. Okay. So in the conduction mode, okay, the on-state voltage drop across the MOS is slightly higher than a BJT. Okay. So in the linear zone, this is in the ohmic zone, I can represent MOS as a resistive element. Just see the characteristics, they are almost linear. Okay. So for the same collector current or for the same drain current, see the characteristics of a BJT and a MOS. See, I have plotted these characteristics for VDS or VCE, or collector current or drain current. I kept IB constant, here gate to source voltage is held constant. See the characteristic, this is for a MOS, this is for a BJT. Okay. So the equivalent resistance in this case is much smaller compared to a MOS. So on state power loss in a MOS is slightly higher than a BJT, and this is one of the drawbacks of a MOSFET. Another point that I discussed was that the capacitance between gate and source remains almost constant, whereas the capacitance between gate and drain varies with VDS. Okay. So this capacitance is high when VDS is low. In other words, when MOSFET is on, at that time VDS is low, capacitance between the gate and the drain is high, and this capacitance decreases as the voltage between drain and source increases. A BJT is a minority carrier device, whereas a MOSFET is a majority carrier device. The current flow in the MOS, in the device, is only due to the electrons. Okay. It has a positive temperature coefficient, and therefore paralleling is easy. Okay. About the safe operating area, in a BJT there are four zones, whereas in a MOSFET there are only three zones. See here, ID limit, maximum power dissipation limit, okay, and CD is the VDS limit. Okay, there is no secondary breakdown limit as in the case of a BJT. Okay, now let's see the variation of VGS as a function of charge carried to the gate. OA is corresponding to the charging of the input capacitance CI under full VDS. See, VGS is very low, less than the threshold value, then there is no flow of current. Okay, when there is no flow of current, VDS is very high. Okay, so OA corresponding to charging of input capacitance CI under full VDS. VDS is high, therefore gate to drain capacitance is very low. So CI, the input capacitance, which is equal to CGS plus CGD. Now CGD is very low, therefore CI is approximately equal to CGS, the capacitance between gate and source. Okay. Now AB, what is AB? AB is, it corresponds to VDS decrease from the supply voltage to VDS on. Once the applied voltage between the gate and the source is higher than the threshold, flow of electron starts. So current starts flowing from drain to source. VDS falls. Okay. So that region corresponds to AB. Okay. See AB. VGS, voltage between gate and source, remains constant. Okay, and the charge supplied is used to vary the voltage across CGD, gate to drain. Okay, now I told you, see, voltage is falling from the full voltage, full rated voltage, to DS on. So as the voltage falls from the full voltage to the on state voltage, CGD goes on increasing. Okay, so whatever the charge that is supplied is used to charge the capacitor. Okay, and this BC corresponds to the input capacitance charge when the device is on. Okay, now what is the input capacitance when the device is on? It is CGS plus CGD on. During on, CGD is high. Okay, so this is corresponding to the device on period. Okay, similarly the change in the voltage with the charge for or during turn off. E to F for the removal of excess charge. Okay. Now F to H is corresponding to discharge of CGD. We are turning off the device. Voltage across the MOS is increasing. Okay. In other words, VDS is increasing. So this is corresponding to the discharge of CGD. Okay. And HJ is corresponding to the discharge during current fall. Okay. CGS, discharge. See, these waveforms we require while designing or while studying the turn on and turn off behavior of MOS. So I'll just show you a power MOS IRF640. Is mounted on a heat sink. See the parameters. This data I got it from their site. ID at 25 degrees, continuous drain current, VGS is 10 volts, maximum is 18 amperes. Gate to source is plus or minus 20 volts. See here, RDS on is 0.18 ohm. It's mentioned here very clearly. The other voltage or the parameters. Gate to source threshold voltage. See, minimum is 2 volts, maximum is 4 volts. Gate to source charge QGS 13 nanocoulombs. Turn on delay, let's see, the 14 nanoseconds. Rise time 51 nanoseconds. Turn off delay 45 nanoseconds. Fall time 36 nanoseconds. I'll explain to you what exactly this mean. They're almost similar to a BJT. See, just now I showed you the variation of VGS with Q, total gate charge. See the variation. And this is the variation of the capacitance. Now, the switching characteristics. If you know how exactly VGS varies with Q, understanding the switching characteristics becomes very simple. See, the variation of VGS is shown here. I have not shown you the variation of drain current because it depends on the external circuit. I have just shown the steady state current here. Gate to source voltage starts from 0, it is increasing till it is the threshold value, there is no conduction, VDS is still high. All the charge or all the current that is supplied is used to charge the gate to source capacitance. This region, whatever the charge that is supplied, it is used to charge the capacitor between gate to drain. VGS remains constant here and VDS falls to a very low value. And when VDS is very low, the capacitance between gate and drain is very high. And this is the same, the variation is same as what we seen before. See, after some time, device is turned off. Same, there is a delay time. After some time, current starts falling. And this is the fall time, TF. Again, I have not shown the rise in the drain voltage because it depends on the external circuit. So this waveform is same as the previous one. See here, on, and this is off. Okay. Now, what are the major differences between a BJT and a MOSFET? So, let me summarize. BJT is a current control device. MOSFET is a voltage control device. BJT is a minority carrier device. Therefore, it has a negative resistance coefficient. Therefore, paralleling is difficult. What about MOS? It is a majority carrier device, has a positive resistance coefficient. Therefore, paralleling is easy. BJT has a secondary breakdown because it is a minority carrier device, negative resistance coefficient. MOSFET is a majority carrier device, so there is no secondary breakdown. On-state power loss in a BJT is low, that is VC sat into IC is low. Power MOS, it is ID squared into RDS on, is higher than the on-state losses of a BJT. Turn off time of a BJT is generally higher because of the storage time. MOSFET is a very fast device. Okay. So, see, here are the major differences between a BJT and a MOSFET that I have summarized. Okay. Looks like except for on-state voltage drop or on-state power loss, MOSFET has an edge over the BJT. Okay. So BJT has an excellent on-state characteristics. The problem with that is a current control device. So if you compare BJT and MOSFET, they almost complement each other. Input power requirement for a MOSFET is very low. BJT is higher, it's current control device. I told you that a small PT is required to drive another PT, power transistor. Okay. Now, can we combine both the devices, the advantages of both the devices, and you come out with a new device? What is known as IGBT? See here, insulated gate bipolar transistor, IGBT. Okay. It was developed in 1983 by Jayant Maliga. Okay. Very popular device in power electronics, very popular. Prior to the advent of IGBT, BJT was used. It was very popular. Maybe till the 1990s or so, BJTs were very popular. As IGBT started coming to the market, the popularity of the BJT started coming down. Okay. So what is this IGBT? Insulated gate, almost same as the MOS. There is a SiO2 layer. Okay. Bipolar transistor, output is a BJT. Okay. So see the structure. Almost the same as a MOS here, almost the same. Okay. You just added a P layer, a P plus layer, and that forms the drain. Okay. See, this layer above this is same as MOS, same as MOS. You have just added a P plus layer, that forms the drain. Okay. Operation at the input stage is the same. When the applied voltage between the gate and source is higher than the threshold value, a n-channel is formed. N-channel is formed here. Okay. So, electron starts flowing from n plus to n minus region. Okay. When the positive voltage is applied to the drain and the source, between drain and the source, this junction is forward biased and therefore holes are injected into n minus zone. See, this was not there in MOS. MOS, the flow of current only due to the flow of current, flow of electrons. Okay. Whereas here, you have an input stage similar to a MOS, a flow of electrons from n plus to n minus. Similarly, holes from p plus to n minus. So, what happens? Okay. Some electrons recombine with holes, okay, and remaining holes are collected at the source. Okay. Now, having this p plus layer, what have we achieved? Now, this junction in principle can block a negative voltage. Okay. I will explain to you sometime later what exactly we need to do for IGBT to block a negative voltage. Okay. Now, there is a P plus and a N plus. So, in principle it can block a negative voltage. Okay. What is the magnitude of negative voltage it can block? I will tell you sometime later. See, you can observe one more thing. See, there was an anti-parallel body diode in the MOS. This is this diode. Okay. Now, that diode is absent in IGBT. Okay. But then almost all the IGBTs, they do have an inverse diode. Now, this inverse diode is built in, which is optimized to match the IGBT switching operation. Okay. Almost similar to a MOS. MOS had a body diode, but then we disabled it and we have separate a diode which was optimized to match the MOS switching characteristics was built in. Whereas IGBT does not have a body diode. In the later half of the course, we will find that this diode is required. So, in the market, most of the IGBTs, they do have an inverse diode and this is built in, whereas in a MOS, it was inherently present. So, that is the difference. Okay. Now, coming to the VI characteristics, how do they look? Let's see here. They look similar to a BJT, similar to a BJT. Okay. Only thing is control parameter is gate to source voltage. Okay. Almost similar to a BJT, a steep rise. So, during conduction, RDS is lower, RDS on is lower, I told you. See here, I just redrawn them. Drain current versus VDS for a MOS. Okay. For a IGBT. So, RDS on for IGBT is less compared to a MOS. What is the reason? The reason for having low RDS on in the case of IGBT, I'll tell you sometime later. Okay. Now, one more thing that has to be observed from the structure. Okay. See here. We had a drain, which is P plus, okay, and a N plus and a N minus. Do we need to have these two N layers? What if there is no N plus layer? What will happen? The operation of IGBT will not get affected, because there is a N minus layer always there. But then it will make a significant difference in the reverse voltage blocking capability of the IGBT. If P plus and N plus are present, like what I showed you in the beginning, both are heavily doped, okay? And when it is reverse biased, or in other words, when I am connecting a negative terminal to drain and positive to source, J1 should block the negative voltage. Okay. Now, since both of them are very heavily doped, negative blocking voltage capability of this sort of a IGBT is low. The IGBT which has P plus, N minus layer is also known as punch through IGBT, punch through IGBT. Okay. See here, N plus layer between P plus layer and N minus drift layer is not essential for operation of IGBT. Okay. If both are present, in fact, if N plus layer and N minus layer, both of them are there, okay, it is known as the punch through IGBT. Now, and that, so therefore, the punch through IGBT cannot block a very high negative voltage. It can block a very small negative voltage, because both P plus and N plus, which are adjacent, which form the J1 junction, it has a very low reverse voltage blocking capability. So punch through IGBT has a low negative voltage blocking capability. So therefore, this is also known as non-symmetrical IGBT. Positive voltage blocking capability, which is not equal to the negative voltage blocking capability. Whereas a non-punch through IGBT, see the structure, it is P plus and N minus, non-punch through, P plus and N minus structure. Now, this junction can block a high negative voltage, because we have a lightly doped N junction, N layer. Okay. So, non-punch through IGBT can block a high negative voltage, therefore, it is also known as the symmetrical IGBT. Okay. So, the structure of punch through, PT stands for punch through, looks like this. See here, P plus, N plus, N minus, and again. Now, if I have only P plus, this is known as non-punch through IGBT. Okay. This can block the negative voltage. This junction can block negative voltage, whereas this junction block can block a very small negative voltage. Hence, this is asymmetrical or non-symmetrical. This is symmetrical IGBT. There are other differences also in punch through and non-punch through IGBTs. I will tell you sometime later. Now, coming to the turn on and turn off of IGBT. The turn on of IGBT is approximately the same as that of a power MOS. Okay. The rate at which you charge the input capacitance, or the rate at which you charge the gate to source capacitance, determine the turn on time. Okay. How about the turn off? MOS, there is only the majority carriers, there are no minority carriers. How about in IGBT? There was a MOS operation, okay, and there is, or the flow of electrons from N plus to N minus, there is also a flow of holes from P plus to N minus. So there are majority carriers, there are minority carriers also. Okay. So in the turn off of IGBT, there are two distinct intervals. What are they? I'll show you. See this figure. The voltage variation of gate to source, same as that of a power MOS. Okay. The drain current starts falling very rapidly, because at this point the channel that is formed between the drain and the source has disappeared. So MOSFET blocks quickly. I told you MOSFET is a very fast device. Okay. The moment the voltage between the gate and the source is less than the threshold, the channel disappears. MOSFET blocks quickly. ID drops. See this current. MOSFET current has dropped. But then there are still minority carriers in N minus layer. There are minority carriers in N minus layer. They will take, or they will take a longer time to recombine. So therefore, ID, the drain current now, falls relatively slowly. Okay. See the slope. There was a rapid flow of drain current. This is the MOSFET current. And this is the BJT current because of the minority carriers in N minus layer. And this current falls gradually. Okay. But it's something known as the tail current. Almost all the minority carriers, say BJT, there was a tail current. GTO is a tail current. Yeah, even an IGBT has a tail current. Why? Because of the minority carriers, the holes in N minus layer. Okay. So we will see how to reduce the tail current sometime later. Okay. So I have not shown you the voltage variation in VDS. It starts increasing somewhere at this point. So during tail current period, even in a GTO or a BJT also, there was a high turn off power loss. Okay. Because the voltage across the drain to source has attained a reasonably high value. So turn off losses will be high. How do you reduce this turn off losses? Okay. Or how do you reduce the tail current period, or how will you make this tail current to fall rapidly? What did we do in GTO? We used anode short structure. Okay. That N plus layer in P layer which formed the anode. By having that structure, GTO cannot block a negative voltage. Okay. But then with N plus layer, it accelerated the recombination of the charges in N minus layer. Okay. This I told you while discussing a GTO. So if I compare a non-punch through IGBT and a punch through IGBT, A punch through IGBT has a n plus layer. Okay. So compared to a non punch through IGBT, a punch through IGBT has a smaller tail current period. Okay. Almost similar to a GT over there. See here. We have n plus and n minus in punch through. So this IGBT has a smaller tail current time. Okay. Now it may not block a negative voltage. So this is the price that you pay. Okay. Now what about the safe operating area of IGBT? It is the same as that of a MOSFET, same as that of a MOSFET. Okay. There are only three zones, ID, TJ max, and CD limit. CD limit. Okay. There is no secondary breakdown zone as in the case of OBJT. Okay. So, IGBT is a device, okay, which has almost all the good qualities of a BJT as well as a MOS, except the increase in turn off time. Now, because of the minority carriers, turn off is not as fast as a MOS. Not as fast as a MOS. Okay. So that is about the IGBT. I'll just show you a module. Okay. A 75 ampere 1200 volt dual IGBT. Okay. Dual, I mean, so there are two IGBTs. And this is a diode connected across it. Okay. The switching time of this diode is comparable with the IGBT itself. This is not a body diode, unlike in a MOS, remember. So these three terminals are corresponds to 1, 2, 3. And these two, 1 and 2, 1 and 2, the control terminals, gate and source, gate and source, okay. A common heat sink can mount it on that. A 75 ampere 1200 volt IGBT. This IGBT does require a driver circuit, okay. And that driver circuit should have the protection circuit also. So one way to protect a BJT from overcurrent protection I discussed in my last class. So driver circuit also should have in a BJT. It should be able to supply a high current during starting. So you require a separate driver circuit to control the IGBT module. There are something known as smart power modules. What are they? That module has the power module, the power devices, plus the driver circuit, plus the protection circuit. Everything is built in. You don't need to use the discrete components to make a driver circuit and the protection circuit. Okay? Everything is built in the smart power modules. Okay. The protection is like over temperature protection, okay, over current protection, over voltage protection. All these protections are built in inside the module. So just imagine or just think the reduction in the size that is possible using smart power modules. A smart power module or intelligent power module. Okay. So these are the power terminals and these are the control terminals, control pins. This is for the heat sink mounting. Okay. What this intelligent power pack consists of? So, I will show you. See, there are three legs. Okay. One, two, and three. Okay. Each leg consists of two IGBTs and two diodes. Okay. Each IGBT rating is 75 ampere, 1200 volts. Okay. Plus the driver circuit for all six IGBTs, the protection circuit, over current protection, over temperature protection, over voltage protection. Just see the reduction in size that can be achieved by using the smart power module. It has three such modules. Okay. These are just the power module. It requires an additional driver circuit and the protection circuit. Okay. Everything is built in this power pack. So, this power modules, power packs, intelligent power packs are increasingly being used in the modern power electronic equipment. And that has resulted in a significant reduction in size of the power electronic equipment. So, one of the reason for the progress in power electronics is due to the progress in power semiconductor technology. It is the heart and soul of power electronic equipment. Okay. So, with that, I have come to an end of power semiconductors chapter. What are the various power semiconductor devices that we discussed so far? Diodes. There are two types which are being used in power electronic equipment. One is a rectifier diodes, another one is a fast recovery diode. Rectifier diodes, where the frequency of operation is low, and for high frequency application, fast recovery diodes are being used. It is an uncontrolled switch. SCR and track, semi-controlled switches. Why? They can be turned on by applying a control signal at the gate. Having turned on the device, you cannot turn it off by applying a control signal at the gate. SCR has almost all the qualities of an ideal switch, except that it cannot be turned off using a gate. Very rugged, and it can block a negative voltage. Okay. A track, which is nothing but, which is functionally equivalent to two thyristors connected back to back. which is used in fan regulators. Then we studied a GTO, gate turn off thyristor. So it is possible to turn off a GTO by applying a control signal at the gate, though the gain or the current, gate current required to turn off a GTO is high. A GTO is a high current device. There are again two types we studied, a symmetrical GTO which can block both positive as well as negative voltages, but then it has a longer tail current duration. To fasten the turn off process, we modified the structure, what is known as the anode short structure. It cannot block the negative voltage. Then we studied a BJT, bipolar junction transistor. It can block only positive voltage, it cannot block negative voltage because base emitter junction is heavily doped. Okay. It is a current control device. The problem with power transistors is gain is low, but then as the voltage rating increases and moreover these transistors are operated in saturation, gain still falls. So therefore, you require a small power transistor to drive another high current power transistor. It has an excellent on state characteristics. VC sat into IC is very small. Then we discussed a MOSFET. Ideal gate characteristics, in the sense input power at the gate is approximately zero. Approximately zero. Input impedance is very high, very fast device, a majority carrier device, positive resistance coefficient, okay. Paralleling is very easy, okay. No secondary breakdown, but has one limitation. What is that? On state power loss is high. Then we studied an IGBT. The device has the characteristics of MOS as well as a BJT. Input is a MOS, the power stage is a BJT. Gate power requirement is very small. But then the turn off time of a IGBT is slightly higher compared to that of a MOS. That is because there are both majority as well as minority carriers. Okay. So this turn off time can be reduced by using a punch through IGBT, but then it cannot block a negative voltage. Okay. A non-punch through IGBT can block a negative voltage. So there are very few devices which can block the negative voltage, a SCR, a symmetrical GTO, an IGBT, other devices cannot block a negative voltage. So that's about the power semiconductor devices. Okay. From next class onwards, I will discuss the various power electronic circuits. Okay. The power semiconductor devices are used as switches. Okay. And in our entire analysis, we will assume that these devices are ideal. Okay. we need to know the two basic laws to understand power electronics. They are Kirchhoff's current law and Kirchhoff's voltage law. Okay, so we will start the course assuming that you all know these two laws. Okay, it's going to be very simple. I will keep the mathematical content to a very low value. I will use the graphical approach. Okay. Mathematical approach is very important. So, if there is a circuit, you can always write a differential equation and you can solve. I will not take that route. I will take the graphical approach. I will draw the waveform and I will use the basic properties of the various passive components, that is L and C. Average voltage across the inductor should be 0. The average value of the current flowing through the capacitor, they are 0 at steady state. Okay. These concepts that you will be using. Okay. So, with that, I will conclude my today's lecture. From next lecture, I will start the power electronic circuits. Thank you.